My cows, they move pastures every day in the summer. And especially in the fall, there's been a couple times when you can see joy expressed. You've got these big old cows that ooh, we're getting in a new pasture and they're feeling good, it's cooler, and they move from one paddock to another and they get through that gate and they start running and kicking up their heels like calves do, like they're playing. And that has to be an expression of joy.
I'm introducing Nathan Buck, Lydia Hicks, and Claire Collins. These three incredible human beings are here to share their skills in storytelling and beginning this year to lead the development of the Greenacres documentary, a new feature film on regenerative farming. The Greenacres project itself will be done collaboratively with faculty and students, and allowing the professional artists and student filmmakers to work on a project motivated by believing in the story, and that story is the Earth, the only story that we all share.
Assuming that's what this place does, we haven't gotten enough information to know.
And it's like, it's a conservation, so it's probably something about like...
They probably do a lot with the trees and soil here, because we have a lot of farmland here that we do care like a lot about the soil. And the soil in Michigan, especially like Upper Michigan, is so nice and great for like growing very specific crops. So they probably do a lot of stuff with making sure that farmers know how to take care of their soil.
Protecting significant natural, scenic, and farmlands and advancing stewardship now for future generations.
It's cool here because we have two branches of the Mitchell Creek, so it's like 14 tributaries or something like that. We're going to walk over. It's the east branch of the 4 Mile Creek, and then where you guys came in was the Vanderlip portion of it. And what we're standing on is, this was an old golf course, so you can kind of see where the sand trap was. We're standing right over the top of the green, what was the green. And I don't know how they did it, because this is almost all wet meadow. The springtime and the fall, this gets really, it gets super soggy out here, a ton of water.
Nothing.
Oh, there. Did you feel it?
No.
See how it curled right up? So check out.
I think I just pushed it.
Yeah. Well, see how it curls right up?
Yeah.
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 And there's any more seed in there? Can't tell if there's any seed in there. Let me grab one actually and see if we can pop it with. Oh, look at this one. I got a good one. Here, okay, watch this one.
Pew! Oh! Oh!
That's wait, cool. That's so cool.
It's 28 or 24 times more powerful than CO2 when it comes to global warming potential, and cattle emit methane, and it's one of the biggest on the emissions. We need to measure methane, and we have those two machines, which they're called green feeds, and they basically measure methane from the animal. Do you guys have questions about the machine and why we are measuring in the head of the animals? Because most of the people think the methane comes from the end, the back end of the cattle. And that's not true. 98% of the methane emissions come from their mouth.
Animals like cattle and sheep have been developed through millennia of evolution, millions of years of evolution, to thrive on grass. to the point where if you feed them grain, it actually can upset their stomachs.
We didn't really start feeding grain to cattle until after World War II. You know, and so one of the reasons we started feeding grain to cattle after World War II is we started having a surplus of grain. We had a surplus of corn. One reason we had a surplus of corn because we had a surplus of nitrogen. The reason we had a surplus of nitrogen because we had a surplus of plants making ammonium nitrate. Yeah, and so we had a surplus of plants making ammonium nitrate after World War II because that's how we made bombs. And so we had all this infrastructure to make ammonium nitrate for all these bombs, but we didn't need the bombs anymore, and so we had ammonium nitrate, so we started using it for fertilizer for corn. Also, we had a surplus of corn. We didn't know what to do with the corn, so we started feeding the cattle.
If I'm a farmer that's not thinking about, necessarily thinking about carbon sequestration like the researchers are, why do I want, and I'm grazing animals, why do I want water to infiltrate as opposed to evaporating or running off?
So the grass grows.
You nailed it right there.
Yeah, this is a sample that never been tilled, never been grazed, never been done anything. It's just in the woods. And then this sample here is from one of our adaptive paddocks. You know, so it's just a perennial, you know, grass, you know, mostly grass, some legumes in there. And then this one represents built environment, pavement. You know, it's impervious. If this could be asphalt, it could be concrete, it could be whatever. And then this is tilled ground, and that's tilled ground that we put straw on.
We want our water to infiltrate so that we can use that for crop production. This tool is unique in that it demonstrates that. What are you noticing with the bare soil in the front jug? What's making it brown? Soil is going with it, right? What's it carrying with it? Yeah.
Fertility.
What about our two samples on the far left? We want to see water that made it all the way through, right? Do you see this kind of hook? This is the soil aggregates that we were talking about. See that?
So does that look like soil to you? Or does it look more like sand? Decent soil should look like a rich chocolate cake. Black or dark brown. Beautiful and malty, textured. This is just sand.
We're trying to do things as the way God intended them to be. Have them eat the things that God intended them to eat and take care of the land at the same time we're doing it. And livestock, I think, are a key to dealing with highly erodible land. The highly erodible stuff that you got too much of this and you end up with erosion. Erosion works. You get wind and rain and the soil moves. So if you don't have something that is tying the soil in place, like grass, some kind of green stuff that's holding the soil, it's going to move. And with our grass, it has got that root system. Every time the grass grows and the cows eat it, the root down below, the top part gets cut off, the bottom part dies off, and then that little solar collector that's still left there starts taking that solar energy and putting it back into growing more root, so that the next time it gets eaten off, it can regenerate again.
I always like to add that we only get one planet. The Earth is going to keep going on no matter what happens. The Earth has survived through ice ages and floods and, you know, meteors and volcanoes. The Earth is going to keep going on. We're not out to save the Earth. the work that we're doing is because we're out to save humanity. This is our habitat. We only get one habitat on this earth. So I like to think that the work that we do is not necessarily for us, it's definitely not for our ancestors. But when we're thinking about sustainability and the environment and the world around us, what we're really thinking about is the habitat, the gift that we're giving for our future generations. And nothing is more important than what you can give to these future generations.